Welcome everyone to the 8th meeting of the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee 2022. I've received no apologies for today's meeting from any members. The first item on our agenda is to decide whether to take items 5, 6 and 7 in private. Are members agreed? We're agreed, thank you. And our second item today is an evidence session on social care. And I welcome to the committee our panellists for the next couple of hours. Joining us online, we have Fiona Colley, Policy and Public Affairs Manager for Carers Scotland, Annie Gunnar-Logan, the Chief Executive for the Coalition of Care and Support Providers in Scotland, Dr Donald McCaskill, Chief Executive for Scottish Care, and Judith Proctor, Chief Officer of the Edinburgh Integration Joint Board and Chair of the Chief Officer Group. Thank you to all of you for your time this morning. We have decided to do this session right now, mainly based on the Audit Scotland report that came out. So that will be our kind of backdrop to all of this. And I mean, many of the issues that were brought up in that report are familiar to us all. But particularly, I'm going to ask questions around the workforce and that fragility of the workforce. One of the most striking things I saw in the Audit Scotland report was that statistic that nearly a quarter of people starting a job in social care would leave that job within the first 3 months, which I found a staggering statistic. And I just wonder, what's behind that? Is it purely pay? Is it purely that they've gone somewhere else for pay reasons? It surely can't just be that. So if I can maybe get your thoughts on some of those statistics that have come out around the workforce in that report and your own views as to what's happening there. And if I can go first of all to Fiona Colley.
Thank you very much. I mean, obviously, we primarily focus on the unpaid workforce, but certainly carers have noted for a significant period of time the difficulties in recruiting staff, whether that's staff being recruited for services that are supporting them or for personal assistance. Carers, when we talked to them about this, discussed the need to deliver alongside better play, better opportunities for career progression, better opportunities for training, alongside those wider terms and conditions. But I think probably one of the most important things and terms and conditions and pay cut sits alongside this is about value in the workforce. I think up until now, up until the pandemic, I think that social care was very much, it felt like something that was a bit hidden. You know, we often talked about the NHS and the really important role that they played, but less so about that significant role that social care plays in maintaining people's independence, in enabling them to live good, positive lives, to support them to continue to work, for example, should they develop a disability. And I think that role of social care has been very much hidden. And I think the profile of social care and around the National Care Service will be part of this, is about talking about how important it is and the difference that it makes to people's lives. And I think that has been part of the problem, and I think continues to be part of the problem and unless we make a difference to that.
Thank you. Can I come to Annie Gunnar-Logan?
Thanks, Convener. Your question was, is it just about pay? And the short answer to that is no, but it doesn't mean to say that pay isn't significant. I think also we should bear in mind that social care isn't for everybody. And in some respects, it's better for people to find that out sooner rather than later. But on pay, a few things to say about that. I think we need to acknowledge the work that has been done to increase pay at the lowest levels over the last couple of years. I mean, you'll know that there's been several announcements, the most recent one being that pay will increase to £10.50 per hour at the lowest level. I think we have to acknowledge that all of this would be much, to present the kind of counterfactual, all of this would be much worse if that had not happened, for sure. So it's good to see that focus. And yet, the way that the pay uplifts have been implemented is, in my view, setting us up with new problems further down the line, because all it focuses on is pay at the lowest level. It doesn't take into account differentials, and it doesn't take into account the career progression that Fiona's already mentioned. And when we look at the pay uplift that's coming up for April, there seems to be some kind of question mark even over whether the increased employer national insurance contributions are going to be funded. So, you know, we're in a very difficult place around all of that. What else can we do about it? I mean, we've submitted a paper to a couple of papers, actually, to Scottish Government colleagues, which I'll be very happy to share with the committee, which sets out a range of actions that social care employers believe will help based on their experience at the sharp end of recruitment. But in the longer term, I think we still need to address the core recommendations of the Fair Work report that came out from the Fair Work Convention on Social Care in 2019. It identified poor commissioning as the critical issue, had a lot to say about the pay per minute culture of a lot of social care employment, and recommended giving social care workers better career progression for sure, but also much more autonomy and decision-making authority rather than just a roster of people to go and visit at somebody else's behest. And the recommendations of the subsequent Fair Work in Social Care Working Group made a significant number of recommendations. You know, yes, on raising pay levels right across the workforce, not just for those on the minimum, and extending the scope of the pay uplift, and a strong, strong pitch for pay parity between public sector employees and third and private sector employees, because we're still operating a two-tier system. None of that's been addressed. Presumably, it's because of a question of affordability. But when it comes to workforce, you know, we're not going to solve the ongoing challenges in a cost-neutral way, and there isn't really any point in pretending that we can.
Thank you. And I'll come to Donald McCaskill.
So the research which you mentioned was undertaken and conducted by a colleague of mine, Caroline Dean, and that report was a Scottish Care report. So yes, pay is one of the reasons why people leave within a relatively short period of time, but of course they know about the pay before they start the job. So whilst I would not disagree at all with anything that Annie and indeed Fiona has said, there are other factors at play, and primary amongst them is the lack of societal value for the role and significance of the work of care. And we saw that throughout the pandemic. It took 8 weeks before we started to clap, not just for the NHS, but for carers. It took weeks before supermarkets started to recognise social care staff as being just as significant as NHS staff and give them priority. And those two illustrations are indicative of a lack of societal value. But there are other reasons. First of all, I think people underestimate just how challenging the job of care is. It is a highly technical, skilled, professional job, and it's not helped by politicians like the Home Secretary describing it as low skilled. This is not a low skilled job, and I suspect, in fact, we know that some people are attracted because they think it's easy. The job of care is one of the most rewarding things an individual can do, because it enables you to help another individual, to support them to achieve what they want to achieve. And that is demanding physically, it's demanding emotionally and psychologically. So there are other factors. For instance, people often don't appreciate the need for registration and the need for qualification. Now, we're not saying that we should abandon those important criteria which denote your professionalism. But I think one of the challenges is that people think care is easy. They apply, and the reality of the demands alongside the rewards takes some time. But undeniably, what holds people beyond that 6 months is the relationship they're able to build up with those they're supporting. What puts them away, because the statistic from 6 months to 18 months is just as troubling, is the reality that, as Annie said, we don't give autonomy to care workers. We pay care workers at the base, and whilst that's improved, it is a little bit like trying to put a Mercedes engine into a rusty mini metro. You know, the system of care and support is in need, as Audit Scotland indicated, in need of radical reform and change. And it's no point in just addressing the issue of pay unless you address the issue of sustainability.
Thank you. And can I come to Judith Proctor?
Yes, thank you, Convener. Good morning, Committee. I would agree with most of, in fact, everything I think that's been said so far. Care's a really, really important job, and I think the pandemic has really hopefully brought that into people's focus. And I think we would welcome the spotlight that's been shone on it by this committee, because it's important for the future that we try and work towards a resolve of this. It is a really, really important job, and I would agree with the comments that people come into care perhaps with a perception, and then they undertake the role and we see how rewarding, but yes, how difficult it is. And I would agree with the outline that Donald gave. You know, people are asked to undertake caring responsibilities for people with very complex needs. This is not by going in and checking on people. We're undertaking complex care for individuals in across the geography that they work in, and that can be an isolating job. It can confer on people a lot of responsibility, and that is quite difficult. So I'm not sure that people understand the reality of that. So I think there's something that we can do, just not in terms of valuing the job, but really helping people understand what the job entails and the difference that it makes in people's lives. So I think we can collectively do more to talk about care. And I think there's something in that about how do we make it an aspirational job? We see people aspiring to roles in health services and other public services. How do we make care something that people aspire to do? And in doing that, how do we attract more younger people to come into care? I think part of the challenge that we've seen is that the turnover is because it's an ageing population, a physically demanding job, but more and more of the people who are providing that care are at an older age group, and that's physically demanding. So I think we really need to think about how we attract people to do the job. We're doing some work in Edinburgh with the colleges, try and shape care roles around the needs of students, to try and match the needs of those students into a care role, make it easier for them to come into care, and that will support our workforce. I think there's a lot around those terms and conditions that we could be doing. It isn't just about pay, but again, I would agree it is also about pay. We need to reward people appropriately for doing a job that is significantly important to society and to the individuals that experience and benefit from that care. I would also agree with some of the comments being made about poor commissioning. I think some of the commissioning practices that we've seen over past decades have not supported us in developing this as a valued workforce and as valued partners. And I think that then drives some of the things that drive people out of care, the lack of continuity that carers have. People enjoy developing that professional working relationship with the people that they care for, but so often we ask carers to do jobs that are disjointed and that doesn't support that. And that's not good for the people providing the care, and it's not good for the people who are in receipt of care. So I think there's a whole range of things around that. And last thing I would add, and just speaking about my own area, Edinburgh, in terms of the pay issues, we do also have an issue in terms of the high cost of living and the high rates of pay now being given in other sectors that's attracting people from care there. So I think there is definitely a geographical element of this. And I'm sure that if colleagues were here from some of the more remote and rural parts of Scotland, they would also reflect the high cost of care and the high cost to carers in undertaking the roles in those areas.
Thank you, Alda. And that's been a really good start for some of the issues that my colleagues might want to dig in more depth. Obviously, I've asked everyone in the panel to respond to me. My colleagues are going to probably pose their questions to each one of you. If anybody isn't asked directly, please just use the chat box and put an R if you've got anything to add. That'd be really, really helpful. And I will hand over on the theme of the social care workforce to Sandesh Gohani. Sandesh.
Thank you, Convener. Judith Proctor, you spoke just there about how do we inspire people to get into care, and Donald McCaskill has correctly described the skilled and challenging work that care needs. Annie Logan, you spoke of the challenges coming as base pay is the only thing that's been uplifted and nothing further. So can I ask you, Annie, directly, why should I, as a teenager, has to go back a bit, but why should I as a teenager or as a young person go into care if it's as challenging as Donald has said it was, if I can go to Aldi and earn £10.10 an hour, when in fact you're earning far less to do a more challenging job? I could go to work for Asda, and if I go to work for Asda, I get similar pay to start with, but there is the opportunity to get a degree, to work up through a career-focused strategy where you start off, lots of people have done this, you start off stacking shelves, you end up as a senior manager earning hundreds of thousands of pounds. So how can we get people into care if we're in this type of environment? And to Annie, directly, please.
Is that for me? Yeah. Thank you. Well, thank you. And you've just articulated, I think, the questions that people looking at a career in care will be asking themselves very precisely. I think the difference between stacking shelves and being a social care worker or a support worker is like night and day in terms of the rewards, the fulfillment, the sense of purpose. Certainly in the third sector, you'll be working for values-driven, mission-driven organisations that want to have the maximum social impact they can have. So all of those are there. But if you are a teenager and you're looking to pay your bills and make your way in the world, then actually, yes, in the short term, you are going to get paid more somewhere else. There's no question about that. But that's a recruitment issue. I think what we also need to look at is a retention issue, because if you like, perhaps one of the more worrying things is once you've persuaded people to come in and they see what it's like and they want to do it and they're there and they've accepted the terms and conditions, is how you then keep them. And that's where the career progression and the autonomy and all the other things that we've talked about will come into play. And in the third sector, employers are really, really trying hard to do that. One of the kind of positives in the third sector is that one of the budgets that we've tried very hard to protect will be workforce development training, in order precisely that people can move up the ladder, if you like. That becomes very, very difficult when you have a government policy which is only about the lowest pay and differentials are being squeezed. It makes it much harder for employers to offer those kinds of opportunities, which will keep people in the workforce. So there's two issues, really. One is getting people in the first place, and the second is keeping them there.
Thank you. And this is sort of the crux of the problem that I see it as, because once you've got people in the door, just as you've said, keeping them is difficult, because actually, if we see through the pandemic, well-being is difficult. The work that people were doing was extremely challenging. And it's, even if we take away the pandemic, the work is extremely challenging. Yes, you're right, it's rewarding. I'm a doctor because of the rewarding nature of the job. But I'm not sure that's enough when you're talking to people who are going into care, because we need to not only keep them, but give them some form of career. So you need to start off, everyone starts off, and people accept maybe a lower pay if they can see that career progression. And I go back to Asda, where you can, without wanting to promote them, but you can have they pay for you to have a degree while you're working. We need to have this clear career progression happening in care, and I would wonder how we can encourage that to happen. Back to Annie, please.
Annie.
Yes.
Yeah, no, I agree with everything you say. What I would say is this isn't only about teenagers and young people. I think we need to make sure that we don't dismiss the older workforce here who may not be looking for that kind of opportunity to do a degree, especially given the future demographics in Scotland. We also need to make social care a suitable environment for the older workforce. And I think there you have a completely different set of proposals where you have the rewarding experience that it is actually counts for an awful lot more than perhaps, the opportunity to do a degree. But largely, yes, I absolutely agree with you that the prospects for younger people will often appear more favourable in other fields. And that's partly about affordability. But again, I would refer all of the colleagues here today back to this report, which is now starting to gather dust a bit, and that is the Fair Work Convention, because it went into all of this and much more. And yet the only thing that's been sort of plucked out of that really is the question of pay. And I'm not saying that pay isn't important, but there is so much more to it than that. And as I said at the beginning, you are articulating exactly the kinds of questions that people are asking themselves when they look at this as a career.
And Don McCaskill.
To follow on just what Annie has said there, I think we all recognise that pay is a critical element, but the Fair Work Commission report on social care, which, along with Annie, I would commend to the committee, also highlighted how important it was that workers felt when they were at work that they were treated with value and with equality. So I cannot imagine any nurse in a hospital treating a patient, getting paid for that activity, and then moving to another bed. And that journey between patients, she doesn't get paid for. I can't imagine that worker not being paid in a clinical setting or taking their break. And yet that is precisely the way in which we commission and contract social care. So it's so important that we don't just look at pay, but we look at how we value. So for instance, electronic call monitoring systems now effectively, as the Fair Work Commission indicated, are the equivalent of electronically tagging our workers. I cannot imagine a nurse in the community tolerating that degree of lack of trust, lack of respect, and lack of individual autonomy. I think we've all said this morning, these women and men are highly skilled professional individuals. Why do we continue to treat people like distrustful teenagers? So if we're wanting to attract not just young people, but as Annie critically said, to hold on to our workforce, can we start to treat them in the way in which we contract independent employers in a way which values frontline women and men in care?
Thank you. And can I come to Judith Proctor?
Yes, thank you, Convener. Again, I agree with much of what's been said, and I think there's no one single fix for this. I think we need to be looking at this across the different groups of people that we want to attract into care. So I think there's definitely something about how do we grow that pipeline and that career escalator for individuals that want to come into care that maybe then aspire to a career in the wider family of health and social care. So how do we attract people into care? It's a fantastic grounding for other caring professions. So where are we as wider public sector bodies then supporting those individuals to train into other areas, should that be what they wish? You know, we have shortages and challenges in terms of attracting social workers, and where are we supporting those individuals into becoming allied health professionals, nurses, etc. For those who want that as a career pathway in, I think they're very, very valuable grounding. But I think as importantly for those individuals who want to aspire to a career in care, how do we make that a job that retains people and does value them for doing that job well? So I think we absolutely need to think about the terms and conditions, how people do that job, how we support them to do that job, how we keep them safe in that job, how we keep them trained, motivated and supportive. I think that's really important, that we create this as a good career, but also a career that can lead you into a longer-term career in other parts of health and social care.
Thank you. And can I come to Fiona Colley before I move on to another question from my colleagues? Fiona.
Thank you. Very briefly, I think, and I wanted to say something about that, about encouraging people to join social care. And I think part of the work that needs to be done is actually talking about that wider aspect of social care, because we've got people who are providing direct care, but there's such a wide variety of roles across social care and what they mean to people. And I think, you know, Annie will probably very much recognise this. I've worked in the voluntary sector my whole career, and the work that different aspects of social care provides to support people, I think is not terribly visible, but I think can help support people to join social care, but also to retain them in social care. And I also wanted to briefly talk about commissioning commissioning and some of the ways that it has been done has been in some ways a block to the expansion of self-directed support, particularly for older people, and that blocks off opportunities. But also for those who are looking to employ someone from social care as a personal assistant, the issue of pay is critical, because if they are not able to offer the same level of pay as, for example, the local council, then it's very, very difficult to recruit staff. So what services, so whether that's in the public, independent or third sector are facing in relation to recruiting social care workers, so too are individuals who are trying to recruit personal assistants. So that equalisation of pay across sectors, I think, is critical too.
Thank you. And David Torrance wants to come in on commissioning in particular. You've all mentioned it as being an issue, so I'll hand over to David.
Thank you, convener, and good morning to the panel. Audit Scotland states that current commissioning and procedures have led to competition between providers at the expense of collaboration. How can commissioning and procurement procedures be changed to encourage a more collaborative and less competitive approach by service providers and to shift the primary focus in decision-making from cost to quality?
So you want to go back to Fiona on that, since Fiona...
Yes, I'm going to go to, then yeah. I'm going to go to Mr McCaskill.
As again, I said, that worked in the voluntary sector my whole career. And I think if you're wanting to look at quality instead of cost, collaboration is absolutely critical. But we've seen really good examples of within the third and voluntary sector of that collaboration, of organisations working together to look at being available to be commissioned for a service. But the reality is that when you bring a level, an amount to that commissioning process, then it becomes very challenging. Whereas, for example, larger organisations may have more of a scope to be able to bid in for a contract, which is paying a lower level of pay. A lower level of terms and conditions, whereas smaller organisations get pushed out of that. So I think that there's opportunities for both larger and smaller organisations to work together. But fundamentally, the HSCPs and or whoever is commissioning services need to encourage that collaboration, and that should be part of the commissioning process. To say we encourage collaboration, we want to see collaboration, because ultimately we want to see what the outcomes will be for individuals.
Annie Gunner-Logan has asked to come in, but I believe you also wanted to hear from Don McCaskill.
Yes,
David.
Please.
Yes, can I come to Dr McCaskill first, and then I'll bring in Annie Gunner-Logan.
Thank you, convener. So commissioning is part of this issue, and the Fair Work report highlighted what was the issue in relation to commissioning. So it's not just commissioning, it's the way we procure and purchase services, and then the way in which we contract organisations or individuals. So undeniably, we've known for years that the system, as it is at the moment, is simply driving standards down, ostensibly attempting to improve quality. So we know what works, and what works is partnership models, alliance models, where you get permission, you get individual providers to work collaboratively, and indeed this is happening in some parts of the country, like Aberdeen. So everybody knows the solution to the problem. What we lack is the willingness, and being honest, the resource to make the significant change. Self-directed support has already been mentioned by Fiona, and one of the key platforms of self-directed support was to enable people to have choice. And choice is only possible if you have the ability to have a market, to use that term, which enables people to choose between different providers. The way in which we contract and procure is driving organisations out of the sector, regardless of their business model, be they charitable or be they private. So what we need to do is move, as Derek Feely's independent review report indicated, and we need to do this fast, not whilst we wait, you know, wait for a national care service. We need to move to a model of alliance, cooperative, ethical commissioning, in which we're not all about price, but we're about quality. The Home Care Association recently undertook some work across the UK, and they have highlighted that there is not one Scottish local authority which is paying what would be independently reviewed as the fair price for home care. So we know the answers to the question. We just need everybody to get round the table and working together.
I'll bring in Annie.
Thank you, and thanks to Mr. Torrance for the question. I always feel like I'm on Mastermind when this topic comes up because I think it's my specialist subject. It seems like I've been talking about it forever. And in fact, one of the first times I spoke to a health committee about this was, I think it was 2009. The big issue of the day then was reverse online auctions for social care contracts, where providers were encouraged to drop their hourly rates in competition with each other against the clock. We've come a long way since then. I think that's the first thing to say. That particular practice bit the dust, largely due to the attention that the committee gave it, and rightly so. And after that, we spent a very long time and many years honing guidance that attempted to distinguish procurement of social care support for people from procurement of widgets, you know, and treating staff as a largely casualised workforce to be tupied from one employer to another without them or the people they support having much say in it. And then we introduced a lot of flexibility for social care procurement in the 2014 Procurement Reform Act. So that's all been good. And we're in a different place now than we were then. But fundamentally, Audit Scotland is correct in saying that we are still experiencing commissioning largely as a price-based competitive exercise for large contracts to provide services that are not specified by the people who will receive support, but by procurement officials who've never met those people, far less understood their individual needs. So for me, the push for ethical commissioning, which is a term that we're hearing more and more now, procurement that recognises fair work and exploration of more collaborative approaches is hugely welcome. Two positive things about that. My organisation is leading a programme of work with Scottish Government funding to support providers, commissioners, people who use support and anyone else who's interested in doing things a bit differently and finding ways to develop procurement practices that respect and give expression to the principles of self-directed support, as Donald has just said, because collaboration isn't only about providers collaborating with each other, it's about commissioners and providers and the people they support and families and unpaid carers all being around the table for better outcomes. And there's a lot of interest in that, so hooray. But we have a team of 2.5 people doing it. The Independent Review of Adult Social Care called for a national improvement programme in this area. And boy, would we like to see that. We would like to see that very, very soon. And the second positive thing is that the Scottish Government Procurement Directorate has recently issued an incredibly helpful policy note, which says to commissioners and to procurement officials, don't wait for the National Care Service. Start now. Check your procurement activity, make sure it's in alignment with the principles of ethical commissioning and fair work, you know, and so say all of us. But the really important point, I think, is that the independent review recommended a revolution in commissioning, but the National Care Service proposals that came out in the consultation last year didn't really follow through on that. I mean, I would go so far as to say that competitive tendering for social care is in itself unethical, and no amount of tinkering around the edges is going to change that. And I worry that ethical commissioning is being kind of being interpreted as a way of making sure that providers behave ethically, but it has to start for me at the beginning with a commissioning mindset that is in itself ethical, and that would rule out competitive tendering in my view, as it would rule out any kind of procurement that didn't involve the individual in choosing their own support. So I could talk about this forever, but I should probably let colleagues get a word in. So thank you.
David, you have a follow-up question.
Yeah, so thank you, Kavita. Dr. McCaskill, you mentioned about Aberdeen there and collaborative working. Can you expand on examples of best practice, please, and collaborative working?
So it's very much along the lines of what Annie's just described there. So the whole process of preparing a social care package begins with that initial conversation with the person who's being supported. She or he has significant input at assessment, they're allocated an individual budget. Good work highlights that they know the options that are available to them and are able to exercise choice. That's all essentially contracting and involving the person. At that point, we make sure that there are providers who give good information, who are able to support the person, perhaps through individual interview, so that that person has control and choice. And then we go all the way through the contractual relationship between those who are paying for the care, which is the local authority, to make sure that that care is autonomous, that the frontline worker is trusted in what she or he does. There's some really interesting work going on in Aberdeen with colleagues of mine around the role of the care technologist. You know, we've so much potential to enable people to live independently in their own home for so much longer by using home technology. And so what that project, as part of an overall work in Aberdeen, is doing is looking at the potential of giving autonomy to frontline care workers and the person who uses this care support. So I suppose there's no one simple answer. There are lots of models, but they have a consistent thread, which is partnership, collaboration, equality of treatment, and critically trust. Because what a competitive, and I would agree with Annie, that a competitive tendering process is unethical. What that has at its heart is collaboration rather than competition, trust rather than suspicion.
Thank you very much. A couple more members want to come in. And commissioning Emma, question for you, and then I'll come to Sue Webber.
Yep, thanks, convener. Good morning to the panel. It's just a quick question about self-directed support, because a couple of panellists have mentioned it now, and we've raised it in previous session of the Health and Support Committee. There's a document here from 2011 that talks about barriers to self-directed support, but also things that help it. So I'm wondering if panellists, it might be Annie or Fiona, have a feeling of how well are we doing with self-directed support? Because in my own casework, we've got people that aren't really aware of it or what it does. So how are we doing with it now?
I think it'd be good to go to Fiona on that.
OK. Yeah.
Thank you. I think the position is variable. I think the problem is it is inconsistent. Some individuals and their carers will clearly be offered self-directed support. It's a straightforward process for them within their local area. They're provided with support and they're provided with information to be able to make decisions. However, that's not consistent, and equally, many carers don't know about self-directed support at all. Many individuals don't know about self-directed support at all. Our colleagues in the coalition of carers asked about the most recent, the previous flexibilities in self-directed support, and the government produced guidance to say at the moment when it's very difficult for providers to provide the support that you need, and breaks was a particular example, and day services were another. How can your direct payment or your option to be used to purchase something else? I think more than half of carers had no idea that that was happening. They had no idea that that flexibility was available. When we came back and talked to carers about it, they talked about some of the things that would have been really valuable to them to be trusted. And I think Donald mentioned trusted. And to have less administrative burden. So if you take on a direct payment, obviously if you're employing someone, there's a lot of administration about that. But even if you're using other options, there's a lot of administration around that. So there's something about really, really removing the bureaucracy around it and really saying to individuals and their carers, you know what is best suited to your needs. You know what will make a difference to your life. And we trust you to be able to either use a direct payment, to purchase infrared from an individual provider, and we're not going to ask for reams and reams of paperwork. We're not going to ask for loads and loads of receipts. We're going to say to you, we trust you, and we're still a ways from that.
Donna McCaskill wants to come in on that.
Thank you, Convener. I think with respect, the fact that Ms Harper has had to ask the question shows the answer, which is we're doing pathetically. I mean, this was one of the most progressive, dynamic pieces of social care legislation, probably anywhere in Western Europe, if not much wider. Maybe one of the problems was that we talked about self-directed support when what we really should have said is this is now how you get it. This is social care. This is social care assessment. And it still dismays me, sometimes angers me, that I hear people saying, there's the social work assessment, social care assessment, and that person is on self-directed support. All social care should be self-directed support. So the answer is the fact that we're still talking about self-directed support as if it's a different creature shows that we failed in communication, in implementation, as Derek Feely said. And from my perspective, the groups that I support in terms of older people, we did research in February 2020, just before the pandemic. And we analysed that only 3% of older individuals living in residential or nursing care accessed self-directed support, and only 5% knew about it. That has not changed during the pandemic, and that's the answer. We're not where we should be.
And Annie Gunner-Logan wants to come in on this before I move on to Evelyn Tweed's questions. Annie.
Thanks, Convener, and thanks to Ms Harper for the question. I mean, where it works well, but in my view, there are some fundamental misunderstandings about what self-directed support actually means. I mean, I still see people confusing it with direct payments, for example, and thinking that's all there is to it. And I think we have to remind ourselves constantly that there are four options in self-directed support. And one of them is that people can say, oh, I don't really want to choose my support provider. You know, can someone just arrange something for me? Fine. But the principles of self-directed support will still apply to whatever service is then arranged for that person, and that they should have as much say as they want in how it's delivered to them. One of the things I think the committee might be interested to kind of look into a bit more is how self-directed support options one and two, and particularly direct payments, were handled during the pandemic. People were not always able to continue the arrangements that they had because the services were withdrawn, or that because of staff shortages and all the rest of it, that people weren't able to access the same kind of support that they were previously. And it was incredibly difficult for those people then to use those resources that they had in a more creative way. Fiona talked a little bit there about the the audit requirements and the obstacles that are put in the way of people who want to spend their resources creatively. And that was a huge issue during the pandemic. I said in answer to the last question that the Independent Review of Adult Social Care recommended a national improvement programme for commissioning. It also recommended a national improvement programme for self-directed support. And I think that we could light a bit of a bonfire under that as well, and we'd be pleased to see that, because Donald is absolutely right. You know, this should be mainstream, and it's not. We still seem to be looking for the silver bullet to solve social care, but this Parliament legislated for it nearly 10 years ago now. That's when that Act was passed. And if we did that properly, I think we would not be facing some of the problems that we are now. Thank you.
Thank you. Can I move on to questions around leadership and Evelyn Tweed?
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, panel. It's good to see you here today. It's actually nice to hear that there have been some positives coming out of the pandemic, which has been that, it's really shone a light on social care and all the things that we need to think about in terms of how important the social care service is in Scotland. My questions are about leadership, and obviously Audit Scotland have highlighted that we also have an issue with retaining leaders within the social care sector. And my question really is, what can we do to help this? You know, what are the reasons behind it? We've talked about other sections of the social care service, but what can we do for our leaders and how can we make it sustainable in the long term for them? And I would like to ask Annie Gunnell-Logan, because she touched on this earlier.
Thank you.
Thank you. That's a really good question, and it's a topic that's gaining a lot more traction now, I think. I mean, the British government convenes a national leadership development programme that's looking right across health and social care, and in some ways it's trying to address the issue that I think you're alluding to, which is there's a bit of a kind of hierarchy of leadership, you know, in health and social care. If you put, you know, health is definitely still the dominant party in that, but I think the thing in social care that we need to recognise is that most of the leaders in social care are not part of the public sector. They are the leaders of third and independent sector social care organisations who often find themselves completely out of the loop. I mean, I was chatting to some of my colleagues about this recently, and if you're the chief exec of a £50 million turnover social care organisation in the third sector, then your main point of contact with the system will be a junior contracts officer. Okay, that's how it works. and, you know, I'm not... As I'm speaking, I'm already thinking, oh dear, somebody's going to say to me about, you know, that I'm obsessing about status and hierarchies, and I'm not. It's just that, you know, these are people who understand their business, who understand the people they support, who understand the mission that they're on, and they are somehow not part of the leadership effort, and they really, really need to be. And this is something that I bang on about endlessly in these meetings that I attend around this, because at the moment there is definitely a hierarchy. And the independent sector is kind of pretty much at the bottom of it when it comes to leadership. So that's what I would like to see change. One of the points I raise again in those meetings is that leadership in the third sector and in the independent sector is actually a much more risky business than it is anywhere else, because if you get it wrong, it's not just your job, it's your organisation will fall over. You know, we're not called into being by statute in social care organisations. We're here in the third sector because we want to be. And that, for me, that's what voluntary sector means, that you're there voluntarily. But if you don't get the right leadership, then, you know, it's a hugely risky business. Thank you.
Dr. McCaskill wants to come in on this.
Thank you, Convener. And thank Ms. Tweedy for the question. The social care sector and the workforce has shown exemplary leadership, especially over the last 22, 23 months. And I think if we're going to solve the crisis of leadership, and we are facing a real crisis, then we need to look at the experience during the pandemic and learn some lessons. So it starts with the frontline worker, the frontline nurse or social care worker, and us respecting their professionalism and giving them the autonomy and trust that I've spoken of. It continues with the necessity that we need to recognise that simply rewarding and increasing the salaries of frontline workers without recognising the importance of differentials, so that actually a senior carer is only getting paid 40 pence an hour more than somebody who's just literally in the door, that's about valuing leadership or not valuing leadership, because those individuals who are supervisors, who are coordinators, who are senior carers, are our leaders now, but also our senior leaders of tomorrow. And it lastly also means that we need to see leadership as a whole system approach. And thankfully, the new work of the Scottish Government is beginning to do that. And by that, I mean that we have to recognise the mutuality of our health and care systems. So it needs to be the case that the insights, the experience, the expertise of leaders in social care are understood and appreciated and valued by senior leaders in our health system. And that involves more conversation, more collaboration, and more opportunity to get together. And sadly, certainly in the last year, there have been significant reductions in the occasions and opportunities for health and social care leaders to get together. So leadership is something which affects the whole of the sector. And at the moment, sadly, because of the experience of the pandemic, because of burnout, emotional stress and fatigue, we are losing many leaders. And in the care home sector, that is significantly because of disproportionate scrutiny, which has resulted in many of these nurse leaders in particular choosing to leave the sector.
Thank you. Judith Proctor wants to come in, and I'll come back to Evelyn for a follow-up question. Judith.
Yes, thank you, Convener, and thank you, Ms. Tweed, for the question. I'll focus on the issues that have been raised already, but also, as a number of Audit Scotland reports have highlighted, the high turnover, particularly of senior leaders in health and social care partnerships, chief officers specifically. It's a role that's obviously been in place for around about 8 years, as long as we've had health and social care partnerships. And in that time, I think almost every health and social care partnership in Scotland has had turnover of their chief officer, some of them on over several chief officers. Not just that, but I think we're seeing some challenges in relation to the number of applicants and other senior leadership roles within health and social care. And I think there's a question there about how attractive are these roles to people who are middle managers, junior managers? Are we making these aspirational, or are these jobs people just do not want to undertake? So I think probably every chief officer would be able to recount situations and where they've just not been able to recruit to senior roles within their systems. But I think there's something in that about how we prepare, select, succession plan for leadership in our system. And this is the same in health and social care, health and social care partnerships, as well as in the third and independent sector. And I think there's a national conversation to be had about how we prepare people to lead in public life in Scotland. And I think it took a while to get the National Leadership Programme project LIFT to also include and embrace third sector leadership, but the opportunities there are relatively small considering the size and scale of the sector itself. So I think we need to think about what programmes we have in place and the support that goes to support individuals once they are in place. I think as far as chief officers go in terms of that specific role, I think there's something about the complexity of the structures that we work within. That was obviously recognised by Derek Feely in his report. That does make leadership across health and social care particularly challenging, given the three organisations that you effectively lead and work within. I think we have to really look at leadership, and I know that the Scottish Government has undertaken some work on that, so it would be good to see the outcome of that in terms of what is the thinking about how we recruit, retain, prepare and support people to aspire to leadership jobs in the future.
Thank you. Evelyn, a follow-up question?
Judith has actually just answered my follow-up.
That's great. I'll go to your colleague, Sue Webber. Sue, you wanted a question on this. Yeah,
thanks very much, Convener. Judith Proctor, you mentioned there about the outcome of the Scottish Government work. And I'm just trying to gather, and some of the issues around that turnover of senior staff in the councils and the NHS and the integration authorities. So how do the working conditions for more senior staff compare with the broader workforce in the social care sectors?
Judith,
yes, sorry.
Yeah. Obviously, there's differences in terms of the roles. So I would never claim that you're not well rewarded in a very senior role as a health and social care chief officer. But of course, that comes with a range of accountabilities and responsibilities in a complex structure, as I say, that would differ from different organisations. I think we need to peel it back and think about, you know, what are the values that we look for and what are the particular skills that we look for in terms of leadership across the public sector and what are the outcomes that we're trying to achieve, and to really then think through how we support individuals into those roles and support them once they are in the role. I mean, getting the job is only part of actually the process. You have to then perform in that role and deliver the outcomes of the organisation that you're working in. So I think there's a discussion that we need to have in terms of what we look for in the public sector or public life in Scotland and how we support individuals into that. I think there's also something, and Donald touched on this, about different organisations and the support that we give to them and the resources that they have to prepare and support leaders. And Donald talked about care home sector. I think that's a really, really important one. Not every care home provider or organisation will have the same resources available to them to support, prepare and retain their leadership. So I think when we're thinking about the resources required to deliver high quality health and social care, we need to absolutely understand that part of that is the preparation and support of the workforce, and part of it is the support and preparation of leaders within that workforce. They undertake a critically important role, and Donald touched on the role of care home leaders, care home managers throughout the pandemic. That would be the same in the care at home sector. And I think if we were to look at the resources available to those organisations to prepare and support leaders, there would probably be gaps in terms of what we would want next to what they actually have. And there's no consistency in that, I don't think, either. But I would imagine that Donald and Annie would be better able to answer that one than myself. But certainly that would be the same in the public sector. Not every health and social care partnership, local authority and health board will have the same resources to support and develop their leaders there either.
Thank you. We now go on to talk about... Did you want to come back in, Sue?
Yeah, I have another question. Is that okay? Yeah, thanks. We heard earlier is also from Annie Gunner Logan regarding the sort of how some of the senior leaders in particularly are out of the loop and not part of that leadership effort, and that may contribute to a lack of trust and understanding of each other's working practices and business pressures. We've got a lot of short-term posts, an ageing workforce, and all these things affect people's leadership capacity. So what can be done to improve the understanding, and what role does the SNP government have in building that trust between the different sectors and leaderships? And could I ask Annie first, and then perhaps Donald, if he's able to comment?
Annie.
Yes, thanks for that question. And I think some of that work's already happening. I think I mentioned the National Leadership Development Programme that we are now involved in, and we're around the table for that, which is great because we've not been before. So some of these exact same conversations and points are being raised in that forum. I think there's an issue about how we break out of kind of siloed leadership. You know, there's a view in the NHS that you can only be an NHS leader if you kind of grew up through the NHS. Same for local authorities, same for the voluntary sector, actually, in many respects. But I think we all have to see ourselves here as part of a collective collaborative endeavour. And, you know, in much the same way as we're talking about career progression up ladders within silos, we need to look at leadership movement across the sectors and a bit more cross-fertilisation. I mean, one more thing that I'd kind of add to this is that there was, pre-pandemic, a lot of interest in what we call citizen leadership around social care, you know, and actually putting the people who use the care services and the unpaid carers into leadership positions. That seems to have gone a bit quiet now, and I think it would be useful to kind of revive that as a concept, because there was some really interesting thinking around that at the time. Thank you.
And you wanted to get Donald
if he has
views on
this. Yeah, if he does, if not.
Thank you, convener, and thanks for the question. I've always favoured a model of leadership which isn't about being so far ahead of the group that you're leading that you can't see them or know their experience, but to be in the heart of the group. And that, at its best, is what social care leadership has enabled. And certainly during the pandemic, managers, whether in a care home or home care organisation, and senior leaders literally rolled their sleeves up and did the work of care. And we saw that over the Christmas and January period, when we were facing such real challenges in terms of staffing as a result of Omicron. So that model of inclusive, participative, equal leadership is the heart of social care. In times of real challenge, I think we have worked really well collaboratively across health and social care partnerships, the independent third and central government. I would like that to continue. And my fear is that, as Annie suggested, we fall back into silos and lose that sense of mutuality and collaboration, but also recognise that leadership requires resources, Judith indicated. My worry is that, as well as hemorrhaging gifted women and men from leadership in our care sector because of the stress and strain of the pandemic, we're not nurturing and growing our leaders in more junior levels, like supervisors. So we know how we can do that, and part of that requires a dedicated resource to enable leadership in the social care sector.
Thank you. Thank you, Fiona.
Annie Gunnar-Logan wants to come in.
Just a very brief point. If the committee wanted to kind of get into this in a bit more detail about what's been done around leadership in social care specifically, then NES, NHS Education for Scotland, and the SSSC, Scottish Social Services Council, will have some information for you about that. And convener, just for propriety's sake, I should declare that I am actually a non-executive member of the board of NES, just for clarity. Thank you.
Thank you. I mean, with anything, and a few of you have mentioned some additional information that you want to put our way, just please forward that on to our members or to our committee. Gillian Mackay.
Thank you, Convener. Audit Scotland have highlighted that cultural differences between partner organisations are a barrier to achieving collaborative working. How can we better overcome these barriers and foster collaborative working and greater integration of services? And could I go to Judith Proctor first on this, please?
Judith.
Okay, thank you for the question. You were asking about cultural barriers as a barrier towards greater integration of services. And I think a lot of that has been touched on. And Donald mentioned the lack of opportunity that we've had over the past couple of years of the pandemic. And I think that is something definitely for us to reflect on, as I think part of the way that we address these cultural barriers is a greater understanding of the context and organisations in which we each work. And a greater understanding of our roles within that. So opportunities for the development of those relationships across sector leaders is really important, such as we saw with the Scottish Leadership Forum, which has been quite active in and around that area. And I think the work that Annie has just talked about as well hopefully will help address some of that too. But I think they are very, very real. I talked about the complex structures that we work within across health and social care. As chief officers, that is very real. NHS culture is very different from a local authority, identity and culture. And within that, within our health and social care partnerships, we're also trying to develop a culture and a way of working that is distinctly different, that does support collaboration, that does support cross-sector working, that does support the integration and the delivery of services as if we are a single organisation. That's quite difficult when actually the terms and conditions of the people that work within that organisation are those of the NHS and the local authority. So I think some of the issues highlighted by Derek Feely in his report identified that underscored some of the challenges that we've got, and what's been what emerges from the consultation on the National Care Service, whether the measures that are put in place and the legislation that is put in place following that actually begins to address that, because it is quite a challenging context to work in.
Who wants to come in? Thank you. Donald McCaskill wants to come in.
Sorry, Convener. I think one of the many conversations I had during the pandemic was with a senior general practitioner who confessed that it was only during the pandemic that he began to really understand what social care was like and what the job of frontline care in a care home, in this instance, was like. And I think Ms. Mackay's question about culture highlights the importance of all of us having the opportunities to learn to not quite walk in another person's shoes, but to understand their world. I think at our best during the pandemic, we've taken off the professional arrogance, dare I say, and been more appropriate and humble in admitting that we didn't know everything, either from social care about the health system or from the health colleagues about social care. So the future I see in terms of addressing the very real cultural barriers, which reports before the pandemic highlighted as being one of the major barriers to effective integration, what we need to do moving forward is to build on our experience during the pandemic, which has to include And at times I've been critical, and some colleagues will know this, about the sense that health and social care have talked to each other, involved and engaged with each other at a statutory level. But the children, which is the 76% of social care delivered by the independent and the third sector, aren't at that table. I think it needs to be a priority as we move forward, that all those who have something to contribute, who are key players, are working together to change the culture. And that is all about listening to each other, shared knowledge and experience, the building of trust, and the mutuality of risk, rather than placing risk upon one partner at the expense of others. Thank you.
Thank you. Can I come to Fiona Colley?
Hey, thank you. I couldn't agree more with what Donald has just said. I think I'd be very much like to see us building on the experience and things that we've been able to do during the pandemic that I think in the past seemed impossible. That very, very close working and particularly the involvement of people who use services and carers at important working groups, for example, the pandemic response group. And I think it's very, very much added value to that group and really actually built an understanding of what carers are experiencing. And I've heard Donald speak in the meetings as well, very, very much understanding about the situations that care workers are experiencing and the issues and I think that needs to continue. But Annie mentioned earlier on around citizen leadership, and I think what is very important is the culture on boards, for example, the integrated joint boards, and about building that collaborative leadership there. I think carers were very pleased to see in the National Care Service the proposal of ensuring that they were equal on boards, that they and people who use services should have an equal voice and should be equally regarded in making decisions about the development and delivery of services in their area. I think we've had probably there's a little bit of tokenism within the integrated joint boards. In general, you have one person from the voluntary sector, one person from who's a service user, and one person who's a carer, and it's a huge job to actually be that person who's speaking for your whole sector or your whole group of people, and often carers have found that they don't necessarily feel that they have the voice that they could have. They don't necessarily feel that they're valued in the way that they should be as people who are providers of care, and providers often of very, very complex care. So I think there's a lot of work to be done on as if the Community Health and Care Boards develop, that there's a lot of work to be done around that collaborative leadership of boards and that equal valuing of everybody on that board in making decisions.
Annie Gunner-Logan wants to come in before I come back to Gillian for the supplementary.
Well, first of all, convener, kind of a big amen to everything that Fiona just said about collaborative leadership and that culture. I think when we talk about culture in health and social care, the implication is often that the cultural divide is between the NHS or health, on the one hand, and social care on the other. But something that I'd come back to that I've already alluded to this morning is the difference in culture between the public sector and everybody else. And one of the biggest cultural barriers we have, I think, is the persistent inability of leaders in the public sector, present company accepted, I should say, to recognise providers as partners. We're not just suppliers to be managed through the application of contracts and contract management. You'll see from the Audit Scotland report that the vast majority of social care is delivered outside public sector, and yet there is still a huge level of mistrust there. And it sometimes seems that there's kind of quite a strong impulse on the part of public sector colleagues, to count the spoons after we've been around for tea. And I think that really needs to stop. It was one of our key critiques of the National Care Service proposals, and I think we might get to that later on, so I'll kind of keep my powder dry on that for the moment. But if all we do is rearrange the structure without addressing the culture sitting underneath a system that sees people who rely on social care as units of cost and their services as commodities to be traded on a market, then we're really not going to get very far. And that's the bit of the culture that I would like to see addressed most of all. Thank you.
Gillian.
Thank you, Convener. To very briefly pick up on something that Donald McCaskill said earlier, obviously for some care workers, there's a lot of recording of visits and things like that. And quite often that's to support families and being able to know what's happened at visits and things like that. But for some care workers, it can, as you said earlier, be used as a way to sort of try and track them and keep track in that level of almost mistrust in care workers themselves. How do we, as we go forward, improve that culture for care workers in particular?
Dr. McCaskill.
Thank you. And again, the Fair Work report, which has been much mentioned already, highlighted electronic monitoring as a disincentive for frontline care staff. Now, those systems were introduced partly to support lone working and to increase worker safety and well-being, partly to ensure that families and others were confident that care had been undertaken. But the way in which they are frequently used, not least to allocate financial return, i.e. to pay the worker or the provider, has become really damaging. And before the pandemic, it was one of the major reasons why home care staff indicated that they no longer wished to work in the sector. Interestingly, during the pandemic, virtually overnight, most of those systems were removed. The world did not collapse. We didn't see inappropriate behaviours or actions on the part of staff because they were and are trustworthy, committed individuals. So I think the answer is that we've got to develop systems whereby we trust, give autonomy to frontline workers. So I would personally like us to get to a context where a home care worker or a home care organisation was able to be contracted in a way that the staff member was enabled to be employed on a contract which gave a caseload, much as happens in community nursing or in other contexts, to give autonomy to that individual to work through their caseload, to identify more need for intervention or lesser need. In other words, to treat these amazing women and men with the trust and respect they deserve, and indeed with the autonomy that they wish. And then we can remove what are quite, in my view, offensive systems which electronically tag these workers.
Thank you. We have a couple of questions that have to be short supplementary questions on this theme before we move on. Please keep an eye on the time, colleagues. Stephanie and then Sandesh, direct your question, please.
Thank you, Convener. Just very briefly, we've spoken about quite a lot of things around terms and conditions and culture, and I have to say I'm actually currently a councillor at South Lanarkshire Council, and I know that one of the things that families wanted most was having that same front door, but with staff in different paying conditions, etc., you know that can be problematic. What I really want to ask the panel is, do any of you have some really good examples of success and what that actually looks like, you know, whether that's shared budgets, shared responsibilities, shared decision making, just really interested in that aspect and things that we can do now, not waiting in the National Care Service coming along.
We don't have time to go around all of the panels, so maybe if we ask
if anybody has a particularly good example of it, then I'd be really keen to hear it. Thanks.
Colleagues, please just like raise your hand if you have something that you want to, or I can come to Sandesh for his question, give you time to think about that and come back. Yeah. Judith, can I come to you?
Yeah, happy to address that one. And I think there'd be a number of really good examples right the way across Scotland in terms of where we've seen integration happen within health and social care partnerships. And regardless of that issue of terms and conditions, I mean, certainly within my own partnership, our frontline teams are integrated, they're co-located, they operate as single teams where we endeavour to ensure that the skills that an individual has through their registration and their profession are used to the best to the best ability to support the individuals that we're here to serve. We're doing things like our Sea Conversation approach in Edinburgh, where we support all our frontline staff to understand how we work with individuals in support of a person-centred approach, what matters to that individual, what's the outcome that they're trying to achieve, and how do we wrap around that with the support and care to help them achieve that. And we're trying in the work that we're doing to include our community sector, third sector, as partners in that work to really be collaborative. And I think you would see examples of this right the way across Scotland, good examples through the pandemic of support that was provided in relation to care home oversight. And I know that perhaps we had a rocky start with that, and I know that for some of our providers there was a sense of public sector marking their homework, as it were. But I think in many areas we got to a really, really good place in terms of how we did that, collaborating with the sector itself to ensure that our care homes had access to PPE, access to support around infection control and prevention over and above that which they provided themselves. So I think there'd be many, many examples across Scotland where we've done that. However, I would say that those issues of terms and conditions do come up again as a barrier to us being able to do it at the pace perhaps we've wanted to, and that has been recognised in the field review.
Thank you. Don McCaskill.
Thank you, Convener. Just very quickly, and it's always a risk highlighting one area of the country over and against another when you're in a national role, but I think what I keep hearing about what's happening in Fife Health and Social Care Partnership is worthy of greater exploration, and that includes a very close alliance between statutory colleagues and the independent and third sector in the delivery of home care, particularly to address workforce challenges during the pandemic and latterly during Omicron. And I know that the independent sector lead from Scottish Carers worked very closely to establish some new approaches to contracting, commissioning and to frontline delivery. I know too that working in collaboration with the care home sector, there has been a lot of mutual work. So I don't think it would be too difficult, as Judith said, to highlight areas where things have worked. And we know why they've worked. And they're usually because people sit together, listen to each other, remove hierarchy where it's inappropriate. And I keep coming back to that word, the word of the day, trust each other. So there are plenty of examples, but I would, for the moment, would consider that Fife is worthy of further exploration.
Thank you. Sandesh, quick question, please, and I'll need to move on.
Thank you, Convener. So my question is about when a problem occurs, will we have a situation where integrated authorities blame health boards and vice versa, leading to sort of a vacuum of accountability, especially with future changes in mind? And that really is to Judith Proctor.
Judith.
Yes, I've mentioned before the complex context that we work within, but I think the accountabilities across health and social care in the situation that you describe are pretty clear. If you're talking about a health board, the accountable officer there is the chief executive. Chief officer of a health and social care partnership in IGB is jointly accountable, therefore, to that chief executive and to the chief executive of the local authority. The IGB delivers its ambitions through setting directions, and these are statutory instruments which neither partner organisation can veto. So they can't say that they're not going to deliver a direction. But a direction, as we always say, happens at the end of a long process of joint collaborative planning. So a situation where a direction comes out of the blue to either partner and should not occur. The way that we work is highly collaborative, and the planning that we do is jointly across our three different organisations. So when a problem occurs, I think we would there, we work through the appropriate governance channels of that and the appropriate reporting and investigation of any issue. But I'm not aware of any situation where an IGB has blamed a health board for a problem. We have mechanisms in place to secure the delivery of directions. We have our various audit reports to ensure the delivery of that. Of course, there's the unique role of the chief officer as both being the chief officer to the IGB, but the joint director responsible for the operational delivery of that direction. So I think there are multiple routes to ensure that the appropriate delivery of a direction, the planning of the service change that the direction signals, and the oversight of that through the governance process is in place. But very happy to work through an example of that if you have one.
Andy Gunner, Logan wants to come in briefly before I go to Gillian Mackay.
Thanks, Convener. I mean, the question is interesting, isn't it? Because it's about what happens when the NHS board and the council blame each other for problems. And one solution to that would be to go back to what my colleague Fiona was saying earlier on about widening the pool of the decision makers and giving all of the stakeholders a say and a vote on local boards. So it's not just the two big ones kind of slugging it out. And this was a question that came up when the Joint Working Act that led to health and social care integration formally came up, and it was knocked back at that point. But I think it's time to revisit it and also to replicate that at national level with a national care service board that has more than two stakeholders involved in it with a say. And that was something that Derek Feely recommended in the independent review, which another one of the things that he recommended, which then didn't kind of follow through into the National Care Service proposals. So I think we could fish all of these back out of the pond again and give them another run for their money. Thank you.
We come to Gillian Mackay on data.
Thank you, Convener. In its briefing, Audit Scotland highlighted that no social care records are recorded in the same way that each member of society has an NHS record. And that makes it difficult to assess whether social care is meeting people's needs. What is the panel's view on introducing a single social care record, and could I direct that to Judith Proctor first?
Thank you. Judith?
Yeah, it is absolutely the case. Every social care system, some of us will use similar platforms because of the pool from which we can commission, but largely the systems that we have in place for social care recording will be legacy systems from local authority and the procurement that would have put in place around that. I think a single way of doing this would definitely be helpful for individuals, but of course it's more complex than just the system that we use. I think it comes down to the paradigm and the way that we work with individuals. So any system is only as good as the way that you want to work with individuals and how you do those assessments and how you engage in those conversations with individuals about the outcomes that they're trying to achieve. So I think we need to start with that. What is the purpose of what it is that we're doing? And what's the philosophy, the paradigm, the way that we work with individuals, and then build a system for that. And whether that's a national system, well, all I would point to is the huge challenges in developing and procuring a single system and the huge cost for that. But then there's maybe a place that we need to start in the discussions around the NCS of what is it that we are here to do? How do we unify as far as possible that which we have? And how do we work towards a system that makes it easy for people to port their care, move their care across areas, and for individuals to have their own access to that and to own their own data? But I think there's a starting point, which is the what is it we're here to do, and then building any systems from that. But I think developing from scratch a national system would be time consuming as well as hugely costly.
Don McCaskill wants to come in.
I think the aspiration of having a national system, which Audit Scotland and the Accounts Commission highlighted, is absolutely accurate and in the right place. My own organisation, together with the Health and Social Care Alliance, recently produced a human rights-based set of principles for the creation of whether a national or a more local data system. And in the end of the day, we talk about data, but this is about me, somebody who might use social care or health services, only having to tell my story once. there is nothing worse than the continuous reassessment of individuals where you've got to go through your story, an often emotional and challenging story on numerous occasions. But what is critical, I think, as Judith said, there will be challenge, but technology has advanced considerably in the last 18 months, partly as a result of the pandemic. So I think we can overcome some of those challenges, and it's perfectly possible that we can create a system on a platform which covers Scotland. But what will be critical is that this has to be something which the citizen owns, that she or he should have access and determines who has access, whether it's the ambulance driver who comes, the social care worker who comes, or indeed your general practitioner. You know, I think in this day and age, it is a nonsense that I have to formally request sight of my health record. It's my record, I should have access. And in partnership with primary care or social care, I think it's perfectly possible for us to move to a situation where the citizen has control over his or her data and doesn't have to tell their story on numerous occasions.
We've got a couple more panellists want to answer your question. Gillian, we've got Annie Gunnar-Logan.
Thanks, Convener. Yeah, we have a programme of work that's supporting our sector to embrace digital technology and data. A huge part of that, the situation that Gillian describes there, is it, you know, yes, absolutely, that's the case, and it's on everyone's radar. We're running a series of sessions with Data Lab to support our members to better understand and use their own data. But in common with Donald, you know, the big question for us is who controls it. We're pushing for citizen held data as the ultimate goal, but in the meantime, citizens having, you know, access and control over their data is absolutely critical. I think there are some big questions about what data are we looking for. You know, most importantly, I think, is data about outcomes for people rather than about, you know, system throughput and institutional outcomes. I mean, they're important, but they're not they're only as a proxy, I think, for data about outcomes. And the other big point, I think, here really is about the challenges we face in our sector. And sorry to grind this axe again, but providers are somehow still seen as outsiders here in being able to access the necessary data from our statutory partners in order to support an individual and also to better understand the environment in order to plan and innovate new services. You know, it's about challenges of working across different systems, technical systems and information governance systems. And we support absolutely the creation of shared data standards, and we're working with members on that. But I think it is very, very risky indeed, and actually quite dangerous, if we're going to impose a single technical system on everyone, because many organisations in our sector have already invested very heavily in this. So the last thing we want is for that investment then to be binned and then them having to invest in something else because it's mandated from the top. With shared standards on data, absolutely, but not a single system.
Okay. And Fiona Colley.
Yeah, I think an individual system, an individual record would probably be very helpful, whether it's technically possible. But I think the question is whether it's national or local is not really relevant, but the most important thing is what it's measuring, and that there's consistency across that. There's consistency of what goes into records. There's consistency of individual access to their own records. And I agree completely with Donald that individuals should have access to their own data. The Audit Scotland report mentioned about not having a consistent way to measure the level of unmet need. So I think there's a good opportunity if you have a consistency in what data is collected, what information is collected, but critically that across all areas that we measure the same thing, that we measure unmet need, and we record where individuals are assessed and their support needs don't meet local eligibility criteria. I think we need to understand the level of need in our communities. And I think that there's a way of doing that through the data and monitoring. I think the point about tell me once is pretty critical, though, because carers talk consistently about having to tell the same story again and again and again and again, and as Donald said, often a very emotional story. So there's something about who has access to that information and not having to tell that story again. So I think whether national or local is probably, that's up for debate, but I think something about having a easily accessible individual record. But I would want to note, and it's a question that was raised by carers around if they're caring for someone who lacks capacity. And I think these are some of the tricky questions around who has access to that and whether carers would have access to be able to support the care of the person that they care for who lacks capacity. So I think that there's some questions around that, and I think we need to resolve all of those issues before developing before putting significant investment into a national record.
Gillian, did you have a follow-up question?
No, thanks, Convener. I know we're a bit tight for time.
We're into our last half an hour, so that's my heavy hint to everyone to keep their questions short and succinct. Panellists, you just have to tell us what you think, so I'm not going to curtail you, but members could maybe just keep them short and sharp. And Stephanie, you have some questions around financial planning.
That's great. Thanks, Convener. And Fiona led into that really well there, actually, talking about unmet needs. So we've got the rising demand as the population ages, and we've got pressures on local government funding. And I think we can all agree that meeting critical and substantial needs really just isn't good enough. That's not enough. We need to be looking beyond that. What I'm wondering, Fiona, is has the level of unmet needs been actually estimated then for those people that fall below the eligibility criteria? And a second question to that as well, how much would it cost to meet those needs? Thanks.
An easy one then. I think no unmet needs and people who fall below the eligibility criteria hasn't been measured. So it's very difficult to estimate how much it would cost to deliver that support. But to give you a figure that's been worked out around the right to a break from caring, and over the pandemic, nearly 7 in 10 carers haven't had any sort of break from caring. If you were to deliver a fairly universal but limited right to a break from caring, the cost would be, we've estimated, around about £500 million. So that's just one element. So if you start thinking about other levels of unmet need and low levels of support requirements, then I think you can imagine that number would be going up significantly. So I think it's about how we choose what we invest in and how we value social care about making that investment.
And Don McCaskill wants to come in.
Thank you, Convener. I don't like the phrase unmet need because I don't think it belongs in social care. Because if social care is about enabling support to allow a person to achieve their full potential as a citizen in the community, to live independently and so forth, then there has to be an element of preventative care and support. What Derek Feely in his report highlighted, and numerous others have said over the years, is that we've stripped out that preventative support from the way in which we offer care in our communities, which economically is really questionable, because if we intervene appropriately early, we prevent much more expensive, often acute and secondary care intervention. So unmet need, as we define it, very narrowly is almost after the horse has bolted. What we should be asking is what resources required in the social care system, not to create dependency, but to foster independence, to prevent harm and degeneration and decline at an earlier stage, and in that sense, to enable individuals both themselves to live more positively, but in terms of the health and care system, to see economic benefit. Thank you.
Stephanie.
That's great. Really, really interesting answers there as well, and answered a lot of the questions that I kind of had as a follow-up there. I'm just wondering, Donald, if you could expand a wee bit there as well on, you know, what evidence do we have about the relative cost effectiveness of investing in preventative care as opposed to, you know, waiting until things come to crisis and then spending a lot at that point in time? Thanks.
We certainly have evidence in terms of the cost of unnecessary hospital admission. I'm generalising here, but roughly £2,900 is the cost for an untreated day over a week in a hospital. The equivalent in terms of supporting somebody either in a care home or in their own home is significantly less. Now, the National Care Home contract at where it is would not be where I would defend, but at least you are in the territory of saving £1,500. That's the economic benefit of preventing somebody from having an unnecessary admission if they're supported in the community, in their own home, or in a homely setting in a care home. Much more challenging is to look at the whole system in terms of what would the economic benefit be of investing earlier in the curve to prevent people from having to purchase or have provided more expensive care and support. All I will say is that before we introduced free personal care, the vast majority of home care delivered in Scotland, some 67%, was what we described as preventative early intervention support to enable somebody to live on their own. It wasn't personal care as such. The vast majority of home care now is personal care. In fact, at the last data I saw, only 3% of home care was non-personal care. If we invest in helping people remain well and keep healthy and independent, in other words, a preventative approach rather than a reactive approach, which personal care ultimately is, then the fiscal saving is enormous, even if the initial investment is considerable. But much more important than that, the well-being and welfare of the individuals who are cared for and supported is incalculable.
Bring in Annie Gunner Logan.
Couple of points on this one. I think I'm right in saying that measuring unmet need was another recommendation from the FELA report from the independent review that hasn't entirely been translated into the proposals for the National Care Service. Audit Scotland produced a report a couple of years pre-pandemic that did actually put a figure on how much it would cost to keep doing social work services in the same way. Was it $3 billion, Donald? I can't remember. There was they produced a number anyway. But the point they were making was we can't keep doing what we're doing because there isn't enough money, and therefore we have to approach it differently. And in that report, they were saying exactly the same thing that Willie Rowe said in Changing Lives, exactly the same thing as Campbell Christie said in his report, and that everybody has been talking about ever since, but we've never actually managed to do it. So two things about that, really. One, in social care, I've come back to my point, you know, instead of looking for the silver bullet, we need to get serious about the one that we've already got, which is self-directed support. And ultimately, you know, if there is a resource issue, which there is, then we need the people who rely on social care and their families to advise us on how best to spend what we have got, rather than making assumptions for them on their behalf. And I think we also need on the preventive agenda to get really serious about what it now pleases us to call placemaking, I think. You know, local authorities are understandably, I think, spending a lot of time defending their position in retaining control over commissioning and delivery of formal social care. But the key role for them, I think, here might more usefully be focused on ensuring that their communities are places where there is a thriving support system of less formal, voluntary, sector-led, well-being-focused support that will, with the ultimate goal of people not actually getting into the formal system at all. And that's where I think we need to kind of put much more focus rather than sort of fighting over who's going to control social care. You know, that's an absolutely key role for local authorities. It'd be brilliant to get moving on that one. Thank you.
I'm going to bring in Fiona Colley, and then we must move on to talk about the National Care Service. Fiona.
Thank you. I think on that issue around preventative support and understanding what the cost would be, what the cost is, I think we know that one in five carers give up worked care. We know the evidence around poorer health outcomes. We know the evidence around disability and mental and physical ill health. We know around long-term poverty. And I think if we look at social care in a silo in terms of the investing in social care for preventative support and what that might cost, we're missing out the other costs elsewhere in the system. And I think we need to have a almost like a whole system model here. And Oxfam Scotland have done some interesting work on care and caring, which I think might be helpful. The Circle Project and Sheffield University Professor Sue Yendall is also doing work on sustainable care. And I'll happily share that information with the committee. I think it might be of help.
Thank you. So a couple of my colleagues want to talk about the National Care Service. Obviously, we could probably do a whole session on that. We will be doing many sessions on that. But just some initial questions on that from Emma Harper, followed by Paul O'Kane. Emma.
Thanks, Convener. I will be short because I'm going to focus my comments on the Audit Scotland briefing that we got. And one of the key messages says that regardless of what happens with reform, some things cannot wait. A clear plan is needed now to address the significant challenges facing social care in Scotland. And there's things that we can do without without legislation. So setting aside like longer term challenges for now, what particular things can be done with the social care sector to address immediate short term issues? And I'll just ask my second question in order to be brief.
Thank you.
And specific actions that could be taken to address the short term challenges.
And will we go to Annie Gunnar Logan first?
Yes.
And then we can bring
yes,
in
please.
Another panel. Annie.
Okay, thanks for that. Good question. And we're broadly in agreement with what Audit Scotland is saying. I'll be very brief because I've said some of the things that I think we should be cracking on with already in this session. One is to do something very serious about pay for social care workers. And you know, you can get chapter and verse on that from the Fair Work in Social Care Working Group recommendations, because they're all there. So and they've been before ministers for a while. So really kind of get a shift on with that. And the other thing that we could do immediately is we could put an absolute pause on any further competitive tendering of social care and put some real effort into supporting the push for more collaborative approaches. And as I say, we're already doing some work in that on that. It's on people's radar. There's a lot of support for it. So kind of give that a bit more welly, I would say. Thank you.
Don McCaskill.
Thanks, Convener. Completely agree with Annie. I think the Audit Scotland Accounts Commission report is absolutely spot on. We can't wait for the dream of the National Care Service, because at the moment many providers and those who are employed in social care are living a bit of a nightmare. So what I would immediately like to see is a national summit is held with all stakeholders. In the recent past, there have been too many initiatives and instances where part of the system has been involved, but not everybody. And Annie has already delivered by the independent and third sector. It is stakeholders making decisions and on basing them on a lot of presumption without the engagement of the sector. So one critical area has to be to address, as Annie said, the pay issue. However, it is all very well saying to a frontline care worker that you're getting paid 10, 50 or 11 or 12 or even £15. If the employer and the organisation, because there isn't sufficient sustainable funding to keep going, collapses. We don't want well-paid care workers on the dole. We want well-paid care workers working for organisations, regardless of their business model, which are there to do the job of care, rather than to struggle to keep going. And at the moment, my membership fears that we will lose a significant number of care organisations because of fiscal unsustainability. So I want a summit where everybody's at the table and not just the usual suspects.
Come to Fiona Colley.
thank you. If I had my top three is more flexibility and real consistency in self-directed support. It's not good enough to have examples of good practice in some areas, and indeed within areas having flexibility and others having none. It needs to be led by carers as individuals, and the addition of short-term budgets to support individuals to be discharged from hospital and support families in that situation. The prioritising of reopening of day services and services that support people to have a break from caring. And I think we need to address charging for social care at a bare minimum, looking closely in every area around disability-related expenditure. Disabled people and carers are the most likely to be in poverty in Scotland, and we need to find a way to ensure that care charging doesn't push them into further poverty, particularly with the additional costs that they face in relation to heating, energy and the services that they are provided. So they're my top three.
Thank you. Paul O'Kane.
Thank you, convener. And good morning to the panel. I just want to maybe follow up in terms of, we now have the consultation responses analysed in terms of National Care Service. Obviously, there's a clear degree of support in terms of moving to a National Care Service. However, I think there's quite a lot of information in there that maybe poses more questions, and it's quite interesting. I mean, 33% of respondents said they were dissatisfied with the consultation process. So I'm keen to maybe just get a sense of your experience of that consultation process and your members' experience, but also, I think, what would you like to see in terms of next steps going into the kind of longer term work on the National Care Service?
And we'll go to Annie Gunner-Logan first of all.
Thanks, convener, and thanks, Paul. What was our experience of the consultation? Well, it was a mighty thing, wasn't it, really? It was 96 questions, I think, in the end, some of which we didn't answer because they were clearly for individuals. So we took a bit of a pick and mix approach to it, and we answered the questions where we felt we had something to say and some expertise and a stake, and we left the rest. And I think most people did that, actually. I've read the analysis. Read every single response, because I think, you know, that would take me a little while to do from now on, because there were 1,300, I think, in the end. But a couple of things about the key points that we raised in our own response to it. One was to look at the proposals through the lens of the independent review of adult social care that Derek Feely produced. And I think I've mentioned a couple of things this morning where we're not entirely confident that his recommendations have all been carried through into the National Care Service. And so we're doing a bit of comparing and contrasting about that, that I think is important. We made the point that there didn't seem to be in the proposals a kind of coherent model of change. I mean, it's all very well saying what you want to happen, but you actually need a model of change to achieve it. And insofar as there is a model of change, it seemed to be, you know, A, centralise things more, and B, everybody tries a bit harder. And we didn't really think that was quite enough, and particularly around the cultural issues that I've mentioned this morning as well. We felt there was a bit of work still to do on the balance between national and local accountability, and I know other stakeholders who were directly involved in that are very concerned about that, but kind of as outsiders, we were thinking that needed to be unpacked a little bit more. We wanted to see a lot more of a central focus on co-production, particularly with people who rely on social care and their families and their carers. And we were quite thoughtful about the scale of it. The scale of it, whether, you know, are we actually capable of doing this, given everything else is going on, but also the widening of the scope. And I think there are still some questions about that, that I suspect ministers and everybody else is still being quite thoughtful about, and in particular the extension of the National Care Service to Children's Services and Criminal Justice, whereas the original recommendations from Feely were very much confined to adult social care. So we had all those questions about it. Looking at the consultation analysis, I think we were not alone in having those questions. So it's kind of quite comforting to think that we weren't just going out on a limb somewhere with our comments. But those were the kind of big things that I think we want to kind of delve into a little bit more as we go forward. Thank you.
Thank you. I was going to bring in Donald McCaskill, but I'm seeing from my computer that he might have dropped out. So Paul, back to you. While we get Dr. McCaskill back.
Thank you. I suppose my kind of follow-up there was in terms of kind of next steps. So in terms of some of the consultee, the respondents, they've asked for, quite a clear roadmap in terms of how we're going to get to, not just the legislation, but also implementation. And I think what Annie said there about perhaps addressing some of these points, clearly. I mean, is that something that, people are keen to see as, I suppose, that set out very clearly about how we're going to make those short-term solutions that we've just talked about and also that longer-term piece of work?
Logan, and I'll bring yes. in Dr. McCaskill.
Short answer is yes. And I think actually, the approach that we're taking to this in CCPS is that we want to help with that. So we are putting some pieces of work in train of our own accord to contribute to the ongoing discussion. For example, we've just signed off an agreement with the Fraser of Allender Institute that we'll be looking at some of the economics around the National Care Service and the affordability of some of the commitments that are being made. We want to look a little bit more at commissioning and procurement. Surprise, surprise, you would expect so, I think, from us. We want to look at the cost modelling for pay parity between the voluntary and private sectors and the public sector. We want to look at all kinds of stuff. So we've got a programme of work which is trying to contribute to this thinking and to support the process that you're describing, where we go from here, because I think we have a responsibility to do that as a stakeholder, and we want to be part of that. So rather than just sort of saying to other people, would you please get on with it? We're very much in the mix here as we go forward. Thank you.
Thank you. And I'll bring in Don McCaskill.
Thank you, Convener. Apologies for dropping out. Another Ayrshire storm that hasn't had a name yet. I like many others, I held many consultation events on the consultation. And one of the participants who was a frontline nurse said, this would burst your simit. And she expressed, I think, the view of a lot of people that it was long. She went on to say it asked questions which she didn't actually want to answer and asked them in a way which were really quite closed. So I think our general organisational sense was that it wasn't as open and as engaging a process as it could potentially have been, regardless of the number who actually filled in the form. But as an organisation, we've submitted our own response, and I don't want to repeat that, though it's along very similar lines to what Annie has said. But just to add that I think we felt that the consultation process lacked the vision and the desire for culture change, and in particular, the lack of reference to human rights, which was so central to the Feely report. That was empty. It was nowhere to be seen in the consultation document. And so as an organisation and as individuals, I think our fear was that the sense of real energy and vision which Derek Feely and his colleagues managed to engender, despite the criticism initially of people like me, but he achieved in doing so, was not present. And like others, I don't want the creation of a monolithic system which doesn't have a soul, because that's what we need. And the last comment I would make is that we found it really regrettable that the prospect and the potential of innovation, not least in technology and its use, was largely missing from the consultation. Because if we are creating a national care service, which isn't just fit for purpose today, contains the vision and aspiration that we share now, but points to the prospect of a much more dynamic, creative future, then we've got some work to do considering what's in the consultation. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Can I bring in Fiona Colley?
Yes, thank you. I think probably just to reflect on the consultation, that there was huge involvement of carers in the independent review, lots of energy around this. And then there was a huge consultation around the National Care Service, and I think the scope was very wide, and we had to involve carers in what was a relatively short space of time. I think carers were very engaged in it, but I think we would very much, I think, appreciate a roadmap. Carers were very concerned that the government proposals became too focused on structures and processes, and not, as Donald mentioned, human rights and enabling people to live their best lives. So I think there's something, the scope goes beyond the remit of the Ophelia report. So there's something around developing the National Care Service on an incremental basis, starting with adult social care and then including other areas once more consideration has been given to the implications of widening the scope. But I think, you know, there was one quote from a carer who said that the National Care Service needs to be properly funded, informed by people who use it and have compassion, good relationships and rights at its heart. So there's a significant piece of work to ensure that carers and people with lived experience are involved as equal partners in the ongoing development and in the new structures and processes, both nationally and locally. So I think there's a lot of work to be done. So I think our roadmap and the steps in the way are very, very important to help people be involved in that process.
Thank you. And Fiona, you've led very nicely on to our final theme on carers. And I've got questions from Carol Mockin. Carol.
Excuse me. Thank you very much, Convener. Yeah, an important part of the discussion, and I know Fiona has mentioned carers a number of times. So we know that in social care, unpaid carers provide the bulk of our care. And there is some thought that perhaps there's an awareness of some of the carers to know exactly what their rights are and what things are in place to support them. I wonder if the panel, Fiona in particular, could share some of that with us. And I think that in terms of time, just some key things that we should be thinking about in terms of a new way of, you know, of a new strategy, a new way of supporting these carers to ensure that they do get what they are, of course, entitled to.
Okay, we'll go to Fiona Colley.
Thank you. I think you hit the nail on the head around people identifying themselves as carers. We know around 400,000 people became carers on top of the 700,000 people that were already caring during the pandemic, and how many of those know about their rights. And that's an ongoing process. Every day people become carers. Every single day, and enabling people to understand and know about their rights is a challenging, because sometimes individuals will only recognise themselves as a family member who's helping out their mum, or they're helping out their dad or their sister or whatever, and not really thinking about that they might have rights. So I think there's an ongoing need for public awareness, ongoing need for that, and I think not a one-off activity, but something that is significant at a national level and in each of the local health and social care partnerships, of a continual public communications to enable people to act, to enable carers to access their rights. It's something that we've grappled with for many years. I think there's some opportunities GPs, and GPs have a critical role in identifying carers, but it's not just about identifying. I think they've got a really important role in referring carers on to support in local carer centres, who I have to say, and I want to at this point kind of pay tribute to the work of carer centres over the pandemic. They've taken on huge responsibilities. They've taken on more activity to try and support carers when very little was available, very little support was available, particularly for people who were new to caring. And I think that it's a very valuable service, and I think we need to invest in it. But as I said, it's a long-term issue around trying to get people to identify, and I think that it's something we just need to keep working on and look for every single opportunity in the development of a national care service.
Okay, I'll come to Donald McCaskill.
Thank you, Convener. Frontline care staff continually talk about the absolute awe and admiration that they have for unpaid family carers, not least during being restricted and opportunities for respite have been withdrawn. But I think two things that they have remarked to me. The first is the sheer mental health impact and distress that unpaid carers are now experiencing in Scotland. And I think we need to give much greater priority to those. We've done a lot for paid carers, but I think we need to give a special priority to that reality. And said the National Working Group on Bereavement, we are also hearing as paid organisations of the need for intensive additional bereavement coordinated support for family carers at the stage in their life when they lose the person. My own perspective, nearly a third of paid care staff also engage in unpaid care at home. And the stress and strain of the last period of time has been enormous. And I don't think the carer organisations and paid care organisations have come together as much as we have for mental health issues, especially at this time.
Thank you. And finally, before we have to suspend, can I bring in Annie Gunner-Logan?
Thanks, Convener. I'll be brief. I mean, all of us involved in social care have been kind of walloped by the pandemic one way or another, but I think unpaid carers arguably have had the most to deal with, not least because they've had to pick up the pieces when other services withdrawn. And I wanted to pay tribute here to my former colleague, Susan McKinstry, who sadly died earlier this month. She had a lot to say about this, including to Derek Feely. Her example, I think, of what she actually had to deal with during the pandemic is worth revisiting in this discussion. I moan a lot about how the third sector gets left out of the room when decisions are made, and you've heard me moaning about some of that this morning, but it's so much worse for unpaid carers because they don't always get told where the room even is, never mind being invited into it. So I would go back to the point that we've all made at one point or another this morning, I think, about giving carers their rightful place alongside all the other stakeholders as partners and as decision makers. And that is long overdue. Thank you.
Thank you. I want to thank you all, and Judith Proctor has had to leave us as well, for your time this morning and very interesting points that you've brought up, which we'll take forward. And of course, as I said before, any additional information or reports that you want to direct us to, please do so. We're going to suspend and come back at 11:15 for our next agenda item. Thank you.